all stand, and we're going to sing Angels from the Realms of Glory.
Angels from the realm of glory, King, your flight o'er on the earth. We who sang creation's story, now proclaim Messiah's birth. Come and worship, come and worship, worship Christ the
morning.
Amen.
Are some of you glad to be anywhere?
Amen.
Well, that's just where we are, right? And those of us that are born again, one day we'll never have to worry about that. Amen. It will be eternally, I'm not going to say Sunday, but it will be eternally praise and worship with our Father. Amen.
Amen.
That will be awesome. Then I'll be able to sing like the preacher. He can preach like me. That wouldn't be good, man. You know how that goes. Are y'all really glad to be here?
Yeah.
Let me tell you who loves you. God. He gave his son for me and you. That's why we are here. Amen?
Amen.
That's not why all of us are here. Some of us, it's a social club, and I hate to say that, but it's the way that it is. But maybe before you leave today, it will change, and he will become your God. Amen? Let's sing, Oh Come All You Faithful.
Come and be
here to adore the Lord and worship Him, and I'm so glad that you chose to be here today. I know that
we obviously have lots that are out today. We 'tis the season, so there's lots of different germs going around, and so we've got some who are out. In fact, Adam and Claire are home with COVID, and so we want to pray for them. And I know Miss Lisa Jones in the nursery is not feeling well, and others, so we want to be sure and pray for one another. We also have others who are traveling. Michelle, she's with her mom up in Mississippi, so I appreciate you pray for her as she travels, and others as well. But it is good to see everybody. I hope everybody had a wonderful Christmas. I do have a special request today. If you are a first-time guest, you'll find in the pew in front of you a guest information card. If you'll fill that out, and then before you leave, there's a little church in the back. If you'll just slip that in the church, that way we will have a record of your attendance and know a little bit more about you. If you have any kind of special prayer request or anything you would like for us to pray for, please put that on the card as well. Well, at this time, our choir is going to bless us in song, so I'm going to ask you if you would be seated.
Is finding their way to their seats. I'm going to invite you to stand as we continue in our time of worship. We want to go to God's Word and read from His Word. On Sunday mornings, we've been reading systematically through the Epistle of Romans, but this morning I want to read out of the book of Philippians. Paul in Philippians chapter 3, verses 13 through 14, says something that I think it's a good reminder for us as we face a new year. We come to the conclusion of 2023, and now, Lord willing, we face a new year. Paul says, starting in verse 13, Philippians chapter 3, "Brothers, I do not consider that I have made it my own, but one thing I do, forgetting what lies behind and straining forward to what lies ahead, I press on toward the goal for the prize, the upward call of God in Christ Jesus." You know, the glorious thing about the gospel, the good news, is that we don't have to live in the past. And I think that I probably speak for most of us as we look over this previous year, 2023. We all had things that maybe we just aren't real proud of. You know, we're all in the process of sanctification, right? None of us have arrived, and so maybe there were some things in your walk with the Lord, maybe there were some stumbles, some valleys, or maybe there was just some difficult times. We're reminded here that we don't want to be looking in this direction. You know, if you're looking behind you, it's hard to move forward. As we face a new year, let us keep our eyes on the prize. The prize is Christ's likeness. Let us look forward to 2024 with anticipation, knowing that the Lord has great things in store for us. Yes, we're all going to face new challenges. There's going to be difficulties, but His grace is sufficient so that no matter what lies around the next corner, we know that His grace will be more than enough to carry us, and certainly we look forward to growing in our walk with the Lord. Well, as I said a moment ago, we want to pray for our fellow church members, many battling illness, others traveling, and perhaps this morning you're carrying a heavy burden. The Lord invites us into His presence, and so let's go to the Lord and let's give Him our praises and our requests. Father, we thank You for Your faithfulness. We thank You for the great God that You are. Your grace is more than sufficient for us as we look back on this year, as we come to this ending of 2023. We all had things that were difficult. Maybe there were things that we're not real proud of. We thank You that You're patient with us. We thank You that You are a long-suffering God. Lord, help us to grow from our mistakes, but help us not to be burdened by the things that we have done that we're not real proud of. We thank You that in Christ, all that is under the blood, and we look forward to a new year, another year that we get to learn more about You and grow. Or maybe for some, this is a new chapter, a new opportunity for them to get back focused in their walk with You. Maybe there are some even here today and they've never experienced conversion. They've never been born again. I pray, Holy Spirit, that this would be the year that they come to Christ. I pray for us as a church, Lord, that we would continue to grow as you have blessed us. We've seen You doing great things here, and we're so grateful for that. Today, Lord, we pray for those who are at home battling illness. We pray for healing for their bodies. Lord, for others who are traveling, we just ask that You would be with them as they travel. And Lord, we pray that You would use the remainder of this service just to glorify Your Son. We want everything to be done in a Christ-like way that honors You. Lord, we thank You again for the hope that we have in Jesus. And so as we continue in worship, may we worship You in spirit and truth. Lord, we love You and we thank You. And we ask these things in Jesus' name. And all God's people said, amen.
Sorry, y'all stuck with me again. I told my husband this morning, I said, I'm hanging in like a hair in a biscuit. Y'all got me again. But this song is something that Jeff wanted me to sing. It's very short. If you know it, for the love, please sing it with me. But it just reminds us, y'all, do y'all know that it's election year this year? That's a rough year. So, and it's just, I tend to lose myself sometimes in the world and just all the stresses of it, especially being a mom. You're worried about your kid. You know, you're worried about the future for your family. So just remembering that the song says, He shall reign forevermore. Just remembering that God is eternal and God is bigger than all of the world's problems is just very comforting.
Gave the sign, bow to babe on bended knee, the Savior of humanity. Unto us a child is born, and He shall reign forevermore. Noel, Noel, come.
Thank you, Bethany. What a great message as we continue to celebrate the glorious truth of the Christmas season, which we celebrate every day. Again, I can't emphasize this enough. I hope it blesses your heart to think that before the world was formed, God had a plan of redemption. We couldn't reach up to God. We couldn't go to God, so He came to us through His Son, and that is great news for us today. Well, as we prepare as a church to observe the Lord's Supper, I want us to continue in our study through the Gospel of Mark, and so today we're going to be in Mark chapter 3. And we are looking at verses 31 through 35 today. Mark chapter 3, verses 31 through 35. And we want to honor the reading of God's word this morning, so I'm going to invite you to stand. Mark chapter 3, verses 31 through 35. The Bible says, "And his mother and his brothers came, and standing outside, they sent to him and called him. And a crowd was sitting around him, and they said to him, 'Your mother and your brothers are outside seeking you.' And he answered them, 'Who are my mother and my brothers?' And looking about at those who sat around him, he said, 'Here are my mother and my brothers. For whoever does the will of God, he is my brother and sister and mother.'" Father, we thank you for this time of worship. As we go to your word, we thank you for your truth. promised that you would sanctify your children with truth. And so we pray that you would give us minds to understand, illumine our hearts today to receive the truth that you have for us. And we ask these things in Jesus' name. Amen. Thank you. You may be seated. Well, I don't think it would be a shock to any one of us for me to say that we live in a culture that is doing everything they can to redefine the family. I read not long ago about a lady who she decided that she was going to marry her dog. And she's declared that that is her family. Today, we're going to talk about the family. And in our text, Jesus, he reorients our thinking regarding this idea of family. In essence, you could say here that Jesus redefines the family. Now, in chapter 3, as we've been working our way through the Gospel of Mark, we see that as Jesus' popularity grows, he becomes more and more of a misunderstood man. He had a misunderstood ministry. We saw that back up in verses 20 and 21. His own family were confused regarding his ministry and what he came for. We'll talk more about that in just a moment. In verses 22 through 30, we see that Jesus has this encounter with the religious leaders of Israel, and they misunderstood his power. They claimed that Jesus was possessed by Satan and that he did his miraculous works through the power of Satan. And today, we're going to see that Jesus had a misunderstood family. And many in our own day continue to misunderstand Jesus, even within the church. There are those who are clueless as to the true identity of Christ and what he came to do. And so today, as we allow the Spirit of God to use the Word of God to prepare our hearts for the Lord's table, I just want us to talk for a few moments around this subject of family matters as we look and see what Jesus teaches us about a biblical understanding of family. And so what I've done is I've taken the text, I've divided it into two sections. So if you're taking notes, let's first of all look at verses 31 through 32, and we find the crowd's interruption. The crowd's interruption, you look at verse 32, and it says that a crowd was sitting around him. So Jesus here is doing what he so often did in his earthly ministry. He is teaching the people. He's teaching the people about the kingdom of God. And as he is teaching, he is interrupted. He is interrupted by his own family. We go back to verses 20 and 21, and it is there that his family decides that they need to rescue Jesus. The people, his popularity is growing, and so there's masses of people coming to Jesus. They all have all kinds of needs, many of them physical needs, and some of them were possessed by demons, and the word is out that Jesus is this miracle worker. And so they're coming to Jesus, so much so that in those verses 18 and following, that he goes back to Peter's house after a long day of ministry. He had selected the 12 disciples, and he's going back to get some rest, and there's a huge crowd of people, and instead of sending the people away, Jesus ministers to those people. And so his family is getting wind of this, and they're concerned about Jesus. They're afraid that Jesus has lost his mind, that he's a lunatic. Now, of course, we know that Mary, his mother, had received special revelation as to exactly who Jesus is. Even her own understanding at this point is still growing as to Jesus and his mission and what he came to accomplish. But we know that Jesus, he had other brothers and sisters, half-brothers and half-sisters.
In John chapter 7, verse 5, tells us that his own brothers did not believe in him. And so at this point in Jesus' ministry, they're out to really perform an intervention. They got to rescue Jesus, not only from the masses, but in their understanding, they need to rescue Jesus from himself. He just can't help himself. And so they decide to go the 40 miles, which has been about 40 miles from Nazareth to Capernaum, and they're going to go there to intervene. Now, we're not going to turn to Matthew chapter 13 and verses 55 through 56, but it is there that Matthew lists out at least four of his other half-brothers, which totally debunks the idea that Mary remained a virgin her entire life. Mary went on to have other earthly children. Probably by this point, Joseph is nowhere mentioned. He very well could have already died by this point. And so here is Mary and some of Jesus' half-brothers and sisters, and they interrupt this teaching session. And so Jesus receives a message from the crowd. I mean, the crowd, they have a normal response. I mean, you're sitting there, and then Jesus' mother shows up, along with some of his siblings, and they're saying, "We need to speak to Jesus." And so you just envision in your mind, here's a large crowd, and one person whispers to the next person, "Hey, the teacher's mother's here. If your mother comes looking for you, you got to speak to your mother, right?" And so they say, "Your mothers and your brothers, they're outside, and they're asking for you." So that's the crowd's interruption. Then we move to our second division, and that's in verses 33 through the end of the text, and we see the Savior's surprising response. Jesus here, he responds to this interruption from his family in a way that would not have been expected by anyone. And through this, Jesus, he uses this interruption as an opportunity to teach a important spiritual truth regarding the most important family, the family of God. And so here, Jesus causes us to understand the nature of the family in a different way. Now, Jesus here in his response, where he says there in verse 33, "Who are my mother and my brothers?" Jesus is not confused. I mean, he's not confused as to his identity. He certainly knew who his mother was. He knew who his brothers were. He's not dismissing the importance of the earthly family, nor is he in any way trying to teach that we should, as people of God, reject or abandon our earthly families. I mean, Jesus had a close and loving relationship with his family. He was not saying, "Okay, you're excused if you're a part of the family of God, you're excused from your responsibilities that you have to your earthly families." We know that because there's a beautiful exchange as Jesus is on the cross. We learned this from the Gospel of John. As Jesus, just prior to giving his life on the cross, he makes sure that his earthly mother would be taken care of. And so he gives the Apostle John an important assignment that John would make sure that Jesus' mother was taken care of the rest of her days. And so in no way is Jesus dismissing the earthly family. He's not saying that you can abandon the responsibilities that you have to your family. In fact, we learn in the book of Timothy that anyone who doesn't take care of their own, that's a shameful thing. That's a sinful thing. But Jesus is teaching us a spiritual lesson here that for those of us who are in Christ, we belong to an eternal family, a family that is going to last throughout eternity. Jesus is looking past the temporal and he's speaking of the eternal. Here Jesus, he's emphasizing that his true family was not biological, but it's a spiritual family. Again, he's speaking of the family of God, the family that is going to last throughout eternity, the family that ultimately really matters, the eternal family. And that's why, as a church family, we often refer to one another as brothers and sisters in Christ. It's good to be a part of the family of God. So that's what Jesus is celebrating here, and that's what he's helping his followers to understand. And so with this short narrative, Jesus gives us some family matters to think about. I have three lessons here regarding the family that Jesus teaches us about today. Again, we're preparing for the Lord's table. So number one, God's family is open to all. God's family is open to all. You see that? Verse 35, he says, for whoever, all right? So, in other words, Jesus is giving an invitation to become part of this eternal family, the family of God, to all who are, by grace, willing to come to him through faith. So in other words, when I say that God's family is open to all, it's available to all ethnicities. It's available to whites, it's available to blacks, it's available to those who are yellow and red, and those who have purple hair and green hair. I mean, you know, you see all kinds of different. It's open to all. It's available to male and female. It's available to the young and the old. God's family is available to the rich and the poor. And certainly this is good news. This would have been good news for many in Jesus' day, and this is good news for us, because maybe today you don't have a family. You don't have an earthly family. You can belong through Christ to an eternal family. Maybe your family has forsaken you. Again, there is this beautiful truth that the family of God is open to all who are willing to trust in Christ. So number one, God's family is open to all. But then secondly, we learn that while God's family is open to all, God's family is limited to some. God's family is limited to some. We get this from verse 35, where Jesus says, for whoever does the will of God, he is my brother and sister and mother. So you see there that the invitation is open to all, but Jesus here limits the family of God to some. You know, some think that everybody's part of the family of God. Sometimes you hear this, they'll say, we are all children of God. Everybody is children of God. Well, in a general sense, all of humanity, they are children of God in the sense that God has created everyone. But in a specific sense, in an intimate sense, not all are part of the family of God. Only those who are the redeemed are the family of God. Jesus is certainly not teaching universalism here. Universalism teaches that ultimately everybody is going to be saved. Jesus is limiting to the family of God to only those who have been born again through faith in him alone, and for those who've been adopted by God into the family of God. Jesus, in John chapter 3, verse 33, as he was speaking with Nicodemus, he said, truly, truly, I say to you, unless one is born again or regenerated, he cannot see the kingdom of God. John chapter 1, verses 12 through 13. The Bible says, but to all who did receive him, who believed in his name, he gave the right to become children of God, who were born not of blood, nor of the will of the flesh, nor of the will of man, but of God. Regeneration in the heart of an individual, this is the sovereign work of his will, ultimately. and not our own. So he is saying that the family of God, yes, it is open to all, but it is limited to those who have been born again. Even his own earthly family had to experience conversion. I said it a moment ago in John chapter 7, verse 5, it says that his own brothers did not believe in him. But then you fast forward and we see that some of his siblings actually came to know the Lord. I mentioned Matthew's gospel, Matthew chapter 13, verse 55. Matthew lists out four of his brothers, James, Joseph, Simon, and Judas. Again, those initially did not believe in Jesus, but yet James, he goes on to be a leader of the church of Jerusalem, in fact became one of the pastors, one of the elders at the church at Jerusalem, went on to write the epistle of James. Judas, it is believed, the Lord used him to write the New Testament book of Judah. And so we see that even his own family, they were not biologically, because they were connected to Jesus biologically, that did not automatically make them a part of the family of God. They too had to be born again, born from above. So we've seen that God's family is open to all. God's family is limited to some, to those who have been born again, which leads us to this question. The natural question is, how do we know that we've been born again? How do we know that today we have been truly regenerated by the working of the Holy Spirit? To be born again is not talking about cultural Christianity. That's a huge problem in the Bible Belt, this issue of cultural Christianity. What I'm referring to is those who, you know, you're raised in church. You're raised in an evangelical church that preaches the gospel, and so you know the intellectual facts about Jesus. Yeah, you believe in Jesus. You believe he was the Son of God. You believe the whole Christmas story. You believe he died on the cross for your sins. And then when you were a child, your emotions were tickled, and you walked an aisle, and you said a prayer, and you got baptized. You checked off all the boxes, and so now you're good. That's cultural Christianity, but that's not to be equated with what the Bible speaks of being born again. It's not saying a recited prayer or walking an aisle. To be born again is not baptism. It's not church membership. Now, these are good things, but if we're depending upon those things for our eternal security, we are going to be certainly disappointed. To be born again is not being a member of a certain denomination. To be born again is not, you know, you sing in the choir or you serve as a deacon. I remember at our first church, there was a young lady in the church, and she had a beautiful voice. And I remember one time, one of the deacon's wife made a comment to Michelle. She said, "If anybody's going to be in heaven, it's going to be so-and-so." And Michelle said, "Well, why do you say that?" She said, "Well, she's got such a beautiful voice." What does that have to do with being born again? To be truly born again means that you have, under the empowering work of the Holy Spirit, under the conviction of the Holy Spirit, you have received new life. You have repented by faith. You have turned from your sin, and you have embraced Jesus Christ to be your Savior and your Lord. The evidence that you have been born again is exactly what Jesus is saying there in verse 35. Those who have been truly born again are those who do the will of God. That is the evidence of New Testament salvation. Now, obedience, don't misunderstand what Jesus is saying here. Jesus is saying exactly what James is saying in the book of James that we studied through several months ago, that obedience to the Word of God is not the pathway to salvation, but it is the proof of salvation. And so to do the will of God, what is Jesus talking about? To do the will of God. Well, it includes repenting of sins. You've heard me, church, say this many, many times, that repentance is not just a one-time act. Yes, there is that ultimate moment of salvation where we turn from sins. But the redeemed, repentance is a way of life. We're always repenting as children of God from sin. To do the will of God means that you hate sin. You turn from sin. Now, I don't want to be discouraging to us. We understand that as children of God, according to 1 John, that we all, even as the children of God, we all still struggle with sin, right? John said that anybody who says he's not a sinner is a liar. So the question is not perfection, but it's direction. Do you see that you are growing in holiness? That you are there's things happening in your life as the Spirit of God is working in you that you are becoming more and more conformed into the image of Christ. And certainly to do the will of God includes obeying His word, to be obedient to His word. Luke chapter 11, verse 28. Blessed rather are those who hear the word of God and keep it. It's one thing to hear it. It's another thing to do it. To truly hear it means that you process it and you respond in obedience to it. It's not like the husband who's in there watching TV and his wife's in the kitchen and she's talking and she's saying things to her husband and she's not getting any response and she says, "Do you hear me?" Yeah, I hear you. No, in that moment he's not hearing his wife. He's not responding. Matthew chapter 7, verse 21, a sobering and very frightening verse in the New Testament. In fact, I think one of the most frightening verses in the entire New Testament is where Jesus says, "Not everyone who says to me, 'Lord, Lord,' shall enter the kingdom of God, but he who does the will of my Father in heaven." Hey, listen, talk is cheap. Everybody, 99% of the people in Donaldsonville, Georgia, if you took a survey, would say, "Yeah, we're saved." But Jesus would say, just saying, "Lord, Lord," that's not an indicator. Is there evidence that the Lord lives inside of you? 1 John 2:4, "Whoever says, 'I know him,' but does not keep his commandments is a liar, and the truth is not in him." So it's desiring to live a holy life. Is that true of your life? Do you desire to live under the lordship of Christ as you live in obedience to his word? Is there a desire in your life to be like Christ, which means that you're willing to forgive others? I said this the other night, I believe, in our Christmas Eve service. Biblical forgiveness is impossible to the natural man. The only way you can forgive like Christ is to know Christ personally. It's to obey his word means that you extend grace. You want to live in his will for your life. You love God and you love others. One thing that I have observed about healthy earthly families, are full of love. They like to be around one another. I'm sure that many of you over the Christmas season, you've had moments as a family where you've gotten together and hopefully there was love there. You like to be around one another. It's concerning when one who claims to be part of the redeemed, but yet they don't like to be in the fellowship. Well, do you have to be in the fellowship to be saved? No, not necessarily. But why would you not want to be in the fellowship? The saved, we love one another, blemishes and all. We love one another. I was talking to one of you this week. They're not able to be here today because of work. And they said, "You know what? I've had to miss two weeks straight. And I can tell because I just want to be with the family of God. I miss being with the fellowship." That's what it means to do the will of God. And so God's family is limited. It's limited to only those who have truly been born again. And my personal opinion is that far too long in many of our churches, in order to bump up the numbers, what have we done? We've watered down the gospel to this simple little, hey, all you got to do, this is all you got to do, just repeat after me, say this little prayer, you get baptized, you check off the box, you become a member of the church, and everything is good, and it doesn't matter that nothing changes in your life. Listen, if you've truly been redeemed, the Spirit of God lives inside of you, and things are going to change. That is the evidence of true saving grace. So yes, we are saved by grace alone, through faith alone, but true saving faith is never alone. That's what Jesus is saying here, and that's what the book of James teaches as well. All right, and then thirdly and finally, our third lesson as we're talking about family matters is, yes, God's family is open to all. There's this open invitation to all who are willing to trust in Christ. It is limited to some, only those who have truly been born again. And then thirdly and finally, God's family is often misunderstood. God's family is often misunderstood. You know, when you come to know the Lord and you're a part of the family of God, not only do you begin to have a different practice, but you develop a different priority. Again, it's not that family relationships are no longer important, because they are. But when you get saved, there is now this higher priority that comes even before something as important as your commitments to your own earthly family. That's what Jesus teaches us. You remember when Jesus was about 12 years old, and he had gone to the temple, and he got separated from his mother and father, and they come looking for him, and they're frantically worried about where Jesus is, and you remember his response. He says, "Why do you seek me? Did you not know that I must be about my Father's business?" Luke chapter 14, verse 26, "If anyone comes to me and does not hate his own father and mother and wife and children and brothers and sisters, yes, even his own life, he cannot be my disciple." And so Jesus is saying that the truly redeemed, we now have this new priority that Christ and our commitment to Christ comes before everything. And oftentimes that's misunderstood. Many times by our own earthly families. I'm sure that many of you have experienced that. We shouldn't be surprised when our own families, especially those in our families who do not know the Lord, they don't understand or just flat out disagree with our commitments. They don't agree with our convictions. What do you mean you're saying that Jesus Christ is the only way? I mean, I think that good people, good moral people, are going to go to heaven. I don't believe in a God that would send good people to hell. What do you mean you're not going along with this narrative in our culture that, again, is redefining the family? Don't be surprised if you get kicked back from your family. When you do, count it an honor because you're in good company, because that's exactly what we see here with Jesus. Jesus' own earthly family, they misunderstood his ministry and his passion, and so they count it off as he's a fanatic. He's lost his mind. And so as God's people, we have to be intentional, and we have to be very careful that we not give in to the temptation to compromise for the sake of our family. And we all face that temptation. And sometimes we've all been guilty of giving in to that temptation, where we allow our earthly families to affect and maybe even sometimes dictate what we will or won't do for the Lord. And so these are some family matters. And I think this is very fitting for us as we come to the Lord's table. And as we approach this sacred place, I guess the question that we need to ask ourselves, and this is a personal question, and this is only one that you can answer, and of course the Lord knows what's in our hearts, but today, are you a part of God's family today? Jesus here, he draws a clear line in the sand. You are either in the family of God or you're outside of the family of God. There is no in between. And that's the most important question that we have to ask ourselves is, am I truly part of the family of God? Am I part of the redeemed? Is there evidence, again, not perfection, but is there evidence in my life that the Spirit of Christ is living inside of me? And so today, as we come to the Lord's table, this is open to all of us who are part of the family of God. And I want to point this out, that we are not here in any kind of way. This is not a sacramental rite that we are doing in order to somehow earn or secure our salvation. But we do this as God's people because of our salvation. This is a time of observance. This is a time of remembrance as we remember what the Lord did for us to provide our salvation. And remember, though, this is not a funeral service, right? Hey, we don't have to wait until Easter to celebrate the resurrection. Every day is a celebration for those of us who know Christ because we know that he is alive and he is reigning and he is ruling. And so this is a time of remembrance. It's a time of celebration, but it's also a time of anticipation as we are reminded that he came first as a baby in the manger, but he's coming again as the judge of the world. And we look forward to that day when he will come and receive his own, when all the family of God will be reunited once again. It's such a blessing to be a part of the family of God. And so at this time, I'm going to invite our musicians to make their way, and then, of course, our deacons, if you would go ahead and come forward. And as they are approaching, I'm going to ask everybody else just to take a few moments right there where you're at, and just go ahead and bow your heads. That way there's no distractions. And just let the Spirit of God examine your own heart. Ask yourself that question. Do I truly know the Lord, or am I trusting in a cultural Christianity? Is there evidence in my life that Jesus is Lord of my life? Maybe today, as a believer, you know you've been born again. But maybe there's some things in your life that you need to repent of. You need to confess it to the Lord, and you need to ask the Lord by his grace to help you turn from those things. We don't want to come to the Lord's table in an unworthy manner. So as Miss Judy plays, let's just all, for just a few moments, let's just go to the Lord and allow him to deal with our hearts this morning. Father, we thank you for speaking to us through your word. We thank you that in your love and mercy and grace, you've made it possible for us to be a part of your family. If we're the redeemed, we have been adopted, and we are brothers and sisters in Christ. And what good news that is, as we live in a very broken world. Lord, as we come to this time, we want to come with hearts that are prepared. We know that your greatest concern for all of us is the condition of our hearts. And so, first, I plead with you, O Lord, if there is one here today, and they're not part of the family of God, they're outside. Maybe they're trusting in their morality, their religiosity, other things, Lord, I pray that as only you can, that you would open their eyes to their need for grace, for their need for forgiveness. And I pray that for the very first time, they would call upon the name of the Lord. They would receive you as their Savior and as their Lord. And then for those of us who do know you, Father, we want to, as part of our sanctification, we want to have open hearts to allow you to always search us. Father, if there is something, maybe it's an attitude, maybe there's something that we're doing that's dishonoring to you, reveal those things to us. Sin is blinding, and sometimes we're blind to the obvious. So if there's something in our hearts that's not honoring to you, would you show us those things? Enable us to repent of those things so that we can walk in such a way that is honoring to you and testifies to the goodness of our Lord. Father, again, we thank you for your amazing grace. If it were not for your grace, we would not be here today. We thank you that while we were yet sinners, you died for us, and we thank you. So, Father, we love you, and we ask this in Jesus' name. Have in your hand, there's two cups. First, we have the bread. We know that as believers, there's nothing mystical about this. There's nothing salvific in this. This is just a wafer, but it's what it represents. It represents the body of Christ that was broken for us. To use biblical language, when we look at the bread and we think about it being broken, we think of the word substitution, that Christ died in our place. He lived a life of complete obedience. He faced temptations just like you and I, but never one time did he ever give in to temptation. And so he hung on the cross as the perfect sacrifice. Provide us forgiveness, but also to provide us righteousness. And so as we take the bread, we're reminded of his body that was torn, that was broken for us in our place as our substitute. Secondly, we take the cup of juice. Jesus told us as he had that last meal with his disciples that the cup represents the new covenant in his blood. It represents his life that was given for us. Because of the blood of Christ, Colossians chapter 2, verse 13 and 14, as the redeemed, all of our sins have been washed clean. Isn't that good news? We don't have to live in bondage to our past. We live in hope. Even as believers, when we still mess up, we rejoice because we know through the blood of Christ it's been paid for. And so we take this cup in remembrance of his blood, his life that was given for us. Father, we thank you for this time you give us to remember the great sacrifice that you offered in our behalf. None of us deserved it, but we thank you for it. Certainly there is nothing we can do to ever fully repay you, but we can live a life of obedience to you and honor of you. So, Lord, we love you, we thank you, and we ask it in Jesus' name. Amen. Well, this time I invite you to stand. We're going to have a brief time, an opportunity for you to respond. If this morning maybe there's an uneasiness in your spirit and you sense that the Spirit of God is drawing you to yourself, you don't have that assurance that you have eternal life, you don't know for sure that you've ever been born again, but you don't want to leave this place in that condition. And so if that's you, you come forward. And after the service, we'll sit down with a copy of God's Word and we'll show you how you can know for sure that you're saved. Or maybe this morning, you as a child of God, you just want to come to the altars and you just want to pray. There's something on your heart that's burning in you. Maybe there's somebody in your life that you're concerned about their spiritual well-being and you just want to come and pray. Whatever it is that the Lord is leading you to do, as we sing hymn number 435, Just As I Am, you respond as the Spirit leads you. Well, you want to be sure to look at your bulletin, look at all the announcements that are in here. I do want to highlight a few things. If you are on the Property and Grounds Committee, I need to meet with you very, very shortly after the service. We'll meet in the Lady Sunday School class right outside the Worship Center just for a few moments right after church. Brother Adam wanted me to announce that next Sunday evening there is going to be a meeting. The youth are going to be going to summer camp this summer. That's going to be available to 6th through 12th grade. And so that's an informational meeting again next Sunday afternoon at 5 p.m. So if you're interested in that, you want to be sure and come to that. Got an opportunity for you to serve Tuesday. We're going to take down Christmas decorations. Yeah. That's exciting, right?
We need some help, and so we're going to start at 9 o'clock. The more help we get, quicker it will get done. Good news is, if you come, I'm going to buy you lunch. So, hey, you know, come. Serve the Lord. Let's use this opportunity to serve him. Again, that's this Tuesday at 9 a.m. Then finally, Wednesday night. This Wednesday night, we're going to have our prayer meeting. There's not going to be a Wednesday night meal, but we will have prayer meeting at 6:30. The youth and the kids will be meeting together. We're not officially having our Awana ministry. That all will start next Wednesday. So the meal, Awana ministry, and everything will officially start next Wednesday, but we will be meeting as adults here, and any youth and children that show up, Brother Adam will be meeting with them. All right, well, it's been good to be in the house of the Lord today. I hope that you have been blessed. Again, for our guests, it's a special honor to have you with us today. Of course, we have the little church in the back where we collect our offerings, and we're going to pray over that. Of course, we're still collecting the Lottie Moon Christmas offering that goes to international missions. If you haven't given to that yet, you feel led, be sure that you give to that. Yes, ma'am, Ms. Terry. That's next Tuesday. Yeah, so this Tuesday, senior adults, you're not meeting. But then the following Tuesday, we will be going to the quarterly Boeing luncheon. All right, let's pray, and then we'll be dismissed. Heavenly Father, again, thank you for this great time of worship that we've had. I thank you for each and every one that you've brought here today. Lord Jesus, I just ask that you would bless each one. Again, we pray for those who are not well today. We pray for healing for them. And then for those who are traveling, Lord, be with them as they travel. And as we all leave, Lord, help us to live intentional lives. And give us hearts for the lost. We've got the greatest news the world has ever known. May we be faithful in spreading the good news of the gospel. Lord, we love you. We thank you in Jesus' name. Amen.